Brady whimpered. Odd, she thought. He only really did that when he wanted to get out for his walk to tend to business. Suddenly, Brady leaped away again, just a few feet, as if encouraging her to follow. She really would have liked to turn back home, get inside where it was warm, a nice cup of English breakfast tea and a toasted slice of multigrain from Huffington's, the local bakery-cum-coffee shop. She'd smear it in marmalade and, why not, butter. Read the paper. Yes, that's what she wanted to do. Instead, with Brady acting pretty peculiar, she started walking in the direction he seemed to want her to go, the lab leading the way with an eagerness that Lou didn't feel. She had to watch her step, not just because of the droppings. Off the main path that followed the river, the land looked flat but was, in reality, filled with ruts and depressions, all hidden by the thick foot-high grass blowing in the early morning wind. "Easy, Brady," she said to the barking dog. "I'm coming, just need to take care." She took a breath, the morning chill clinging to her lungs. Now Brady charged ahead. They were close to where the river forked, one side wandering to the weir on the right, while the left fork kept meandering its way down to the other villages that it lazily rolled by. The mighty Thames, here but a sleepy river. Brady had stopped. Once again he had turned to stone, standing stock still and looking across to the weir. His gaze was focused directly on the shallow waters where the stream frothed and bubbled. She came abreast of her dog, reached down and gave his head a slow stroke. "Don't know what you see, boy. Maybe there are rabbits over there on the other side, but..." She stopped. At first it was one of those moments, happening more now with age, where you see something and, as Lou increasingly knew, you say, "Oh, that's a..." And you guess it's this. Then, as you look at it closer, take a step nearer, you make another guess. She did that now and saw what looked like a bit of cloth, shiny, sparkly, festive, glimmering even in this dull morning light, competing with the shimmering river water. She moved closer and realised that she was looking at clothes, a skirt of some kind, and something dull but still white, a blouse. Her mind quickly filled in the details. Perhaps a part of her even knew before she actually acknowledged it what exactly she was looking at. An area of muddy brown turned out to be a bowed head, chin to chest, face and eyes hidden. And as that became clear, Lou slowly started to make sense of what she could see. Arms poking out of a blouse, one at a near horizontal to the body, fingers lazily pointing east, the other dangling in the rushing water, its hand hidden. "Dear sweet God," Lou said to herself. Brady had been whimpering, but at the sound of her voice turned to look at her. To Lou, it seemed as though his eyes were sad, as if he knew this was wrong. And though normally she would let her dog just bounce and gamble his way back to the village, racing to her small cottage just outside the main square, now she dug the leash out of her pocket and clipped it to Brady's worn collar. She wanted him beside her, even if he tugged and pulled as she made her way back to the village, to the police, to tell them what she had seen. Chapter 2. Sarah and Sammy. Sarah turned off the TV. "All right, you lot, now you're late. Grab your bags and lunches fast and let's move." As she piled the cereal bowls in the sink, Sarah watched her two children, Chloe, 13, and Daniel, 10, drift slowly out towards the hall. Though they didn't complain much about school, they certainly didn't radiate eagerness in the morning, and Chloe seemed to grow more secretive and quiet by the day. "Reminds me of me," Sarah thought. "What a handful I was." She did a quick scan of the kitchen to make sure everything electric was off. Only a few weeks ago, some little old lady in one of the sheltered flats at the far end of the village had let a toaster turn her flat into toast. She'd got into the habit of double-checking everything. After all, look what happened to my lovely marriage. One minute a happy couple, then all the cheating comes out, and suddenly, here we are, a stereotype. Two kids, single mum of a certain age, whatever that was supposed to mean. The children started trudging out of the little semi to the RAV4, one of the few things she was able to salvage from the wreck of her London life. "You can have the car and the remaining 12 payments," Oliver had said with a grin.
bastard.
She pulled the front door tight and stepped over Chloe and Daniel's bikes. God, that lawn needed mowing. It was only a tiny patch, but somehow it was like a meadow. She couldn't do it today, though. Busy day ahead. 3 good web pitches to sort. She liked to keep as busy as possible, and it seemed lately, between the children and the studio, she had nothing to worry about on that score. After dropping off Chloe, she stopped at Cheringham Primary. At 8:30 on a weekday morning, the stretch of road outside the school turned into a Grand Prix pit stop. Mums and dads thronged at the main gate. Prams and buggies jostled. Cars weaved in and out, dropping off children in record time before shooting off down the road. As usual, there was nowhere to park, so she stopped in the middle of the road and waited while Daniel climbed out the back. "Got swimming tonight, Mum, so I'll be late." "All right, love, see you at home," said Sarah, waiting for the door to slam. But before she could pull away, a face leaned in through her open window. The dreaded Angela.
"Shocking, isn't it?"
said Angela, her chubby cheeks pink with the effort of holding a dribbling toddler high on her shoulder. "Hmm? What?" Sarah said absently. Angela served as the key hub in the village gossip machine, and very little escaped her notice or her condemnation. Sarah waited politely for today's instalment to be completed. She wasn't prepared for what Angela said next.
"And you must be so upset, what with her being your best mate and all."
Suddenly Angela's words cut through the morning air, matching the chilling wind as the woman hovered by the window. "What are you talking about, Angela?" Sarah asked impatiently.
"Sammy Charlton, of course," said Angela. "I just assumed someone would have told you. They reckon it was an overdose. Wouldn't surprise me. She used to do all sorts of things, didn't she? Well, not that I'm saying you did too, of course."
"Angela?" Sarah kept her voice steady. She and Sammy had been such good friends. But that was long ago, before London, before Sammy vanished. "What's happened to Sammy?" said Sarah, dreading the answer.
"Oh, they found her down in the weir this morning. Drowned. Thought for sure someone would have told..."
Angela tailed off. Sarah felt her stomach turn.
Sammy dead.
For all of her friend's craziness, that seemed unreal. And not just dead, but dead here, after so many years away, back in the village where they had both grown up.
"Are you sure?"
A car behind Sarah hooted impatiently. Angela began to turn away before giving her final judgment on the matter.
"Oh, yes, dear, no doubt about it. Dead as they come."
Sarah parked in the square and picked up a coffee from Huffington's before heading to the studio. The ground floor estate agents didn't open till 10, and she was usually first into the building. Picking up the post, she climbed the flights of narrow stairs to the top floor, where she turned on the computers on her desk and went over to the window. From here, 3 floors up, she could see down into the village square and also across the rooftops to the river and the far meadows. There wasn't a lot of room, but with a view like that, she loved her office. From up here, the weir was hidden by dense trees, but she could see that the traffic heading to the toll bridge was slow-moving, crawling. The police must still be down there. A body found in their quiet little village. She sipped the coffee. It was so hot. She still couldn't believe it. Sammy dead? Sammy had been her mate, all right, but that word couldn't possibly convey what she and Sammy had meant to each other. Sammy had been her true pal, her best friend, her shoulder to cry on, her partner in crime all through their teen years, through GCSEs and A-levels. They had laughed, danced, played and drunk together during the most intense and possibly the best part of their lives. One year they even shared boyfriends. God, what a mess that had been. Although later they had managed to laugh about it as they compared notes. And then, funny how it always happens, they just got used to not seeing each other much, each picking a different path. Sammy went off to drama school while Sarah went to university. Sammy went around the world chasing her dream of being an actor while Sarah moved to London, got a job, married Oliver and had children. But slowly Sarah started to see warning signs that all was not well. Every once in a while Sammy would turn up unannounced needing a bed for the night and, after a prickly start, the two of them would open a bottle of wine, then another, and another. They'd reminisce, and Sammy would talk till dawn about her hair-raising adventures.
Then she would go off to the airport and Sarah wouldn't see her again. Till next time. The last time she had seen Sammy had been 2 years ago, in London, when she and Oliver were still together. Sammy was apparently modelling in Tokyo, though it all sounded dodgy to Sarah. This time, with the children in bed, the three of them had stayed up drinking too much. As the evening wore on, Sammy turned flirty with Oliver, too flirty for Sarah's liking. But Oliver, another early warning sign, hadn't seemed to mind. There'd been a massive row and everyone had gone to bed angry. Sammy had left for the airport at dawn without saying goodbye, and Sarah hadn't seen her since. Nor ever would again, she realised. She looked down at the village square, at the tea rooms, the cafe, the bus shelter, the old pub, the Angel, the stone bench outside the village hall, the library with its big porch. Once upon a time she and Sammy had owned that square. It had been their patch, every square inch of it. Sarah wiped her eyes, sat at her desk, logged on and started to work. Things happen. She knew that all too well. She had 3 website design pitches to finish today, and she didn't have time for memories. At least, not yet. Chapter 3. The Cause of Death.
All right, everybody, so we will carry on with that story the next time. All right. Sorry about that. Next up is a song by Demi Lovato. Met him last night from her new album. But before we do that, we are going to have a little fact session about her. Her real name is Demetria Devon Lovato. She was born on August 28th. 20th. Yeah. Sorry. I almost said 28. I don't know why. In Albuquerque, New Mexico. If you didn't know that, then also, she used to be on Barney and Friends. She has come a long way from Barney and Friends and the Camp Rock and all the other stuff. And Sunny with a Chance and Will and Grace and the Pretentious. Sorry. I don't know why I stuttered for a moment. Princess Protection Program. She's played in a lot of stuff, everybody. She has sold over 24 million records. Two Latin American Music Awards and Guinness World Record included a Time 100 annual list in 2017. That is crazy. But, that's a lot of records, huh? She's one of my favorite artists as well. But we will go ahead and play this song for you. Here we go.
Yeah, I met him last night. Had conversation, yeah, I think he's alright. Seemed kinda funny, yeah, he kinda my type. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I seen the devil.